Today, I'm going to narrate something quite important for people who are on a path, on a kind of a spiritual path. And I don't know how long it's going to last, but you can always stop and start again a bit later. But I don't think it's going to be all that long. But I'm going to tell a little bit about my spiritual journey, just some important salient aspects of it, and hopefully for some of you, it, if not now but at a later stage, it will give you some interesting kind of vision, understanding. You might go, ah yeah, that I remember what Carlos said, yeah, that makes sense, it's useful to me. So let us say, when I went at 17 to India after a very long journey, I followed, as many of you know, a group of yogis up in the mountains. So the first part of my life, the aspect, from 17 till about, I don't know, 25, 27, 30 and so forth, it was very much about a kind of concentration. You meditate on a particular image, a particular feeling, a particular sound, and so you let go of the power that the external world has on you, and you begin to find your kind of peace, your kind of slowing down of thoughts, and being careful to understand things in a loving, in a very kind way, in a letting go most of the time, because sometimes it's not possible. So this first part is a concentration. You are concentrating on your breath, or you are concentrating on a mantra, or any other things, or on images that you look, and you try to do so that your mind doesn't go all over the place, and you start becoming into a state of kind of oneness or unity. However, it's done with a certain concentration and with effort, okay? But so it was very good. It was a very beautiful journey. It had very beautiful experiences. I met all kind of yogis that showed me different paths and so forth. And sometimes just letting go, breathing, just being in the moment and so forth. Later on, after 30, I began to start psychoanalysis, psychiatry, and so forth. I mean, to do it, because I had this very strong feeling that I was very conditioned by my past, as most people, if not all people, we are. So I went and did the Reiki therapy and other forms of therapy, to understand my childhood, the relationship with my parents, with people around me. And it was very, very important for me. It's not essential. It's not essential. I'm not saying, oh, well, if you're not doing that, that's it. No, because you can always release things that are blocking your nature, your understanding. You can do that just by releasing, letting go of contractions. But I went through the whole rigmarole, the whole path and so forth, and it was very important. Over the years, I was able to understand, you know, which things blocked me. I also had to be very careful about not grasping at psychoanalytical ideas, and then I started inventing problems. I had to really be careful not to swallow too much, but to see that this is creating a certain blockage in me. I can see it creates me pain, it creates me sorrow. And there is then this beautiful path of somehow letting it go. So anyhow, we go like this, and so we release, there is a certain letting go. There is an understanding, better understanding with other people, and so forth. But still, there is a certain path to follow, still to go through. But it begins to get more and more free, and so forth. Now, one day, I was at the talk of a very, very beautiful Buddhist monk. It was a bit quite unique, not someone that follows things really exactly at the letter and so forth, and very joyous. So anyhow, he's talking at this meeting. There weren't that many of us. And at one point he said, it is not your thoughts that are really your personality, but it is who you really are, and that is pure consciousness. And that was quite unique, because in a split second, I went, bang, yeah, I am consciousness. I am consciousness from which thoughts arise, and nothing wrong with them. You welcome them, you let them flow, you understand them, you release them. But there is this immense joy, and it's not I am pure consciousness in the sense that I am pure consciousness, because that's not a very good experience. But by that, it's just pure joy and simplicity, you know, not who I am. It is, no, you just are. That's it, you just are. And so the consciousness is that knowledge, which is not thought knowledge, but it's just this wonderful feeling, release and letting go. So you might have heard about this experience in quite a few different talks and places. So here you are, the realization of your essence of consciousness, which makes you very, very, very simple, very childlike. It's even more, there is consciousness rather than I am consciousness. I remember someone once said, how can I be humble if I am pure consciousness? And it's not humble, you are simple, or there is a certain simplicity. But when the I is saying, I am, simple, humble I, wow, I'm so great, you haven't had the experience, really. It's about a kind of state of unnecessary pride. So anyhow, so you go into this beautiful, blissful state of pure being. And I'm not saying it like, oh, wow, it is simple. I remember saying to the monk, but this is so simple. And he looked at me and he said, yeah, that is very simple. Come for a cup of tea afterwards and let's have a little chat, which was really, really nice. So anyhow, so I was in that state of joy, pure being, which I've heard quite a few people these days achieving. And a few days went by, and then one morning I woke up, and from that openness, from that consciousness, what had really arose is an incredible state of love. You know, that kind of because we'll have to discuss it a bit more, of no self, just allows the real essence of this universe, which is this immense love. And you have heard quite a few people talking about that, just pure being, pure love, and again, simplicity. So time went by. Looking back in those days to different gurus I've had that had touched those states of being, and knowing people that have touched those states of being, and to a certain extent having experienced that within me, I started reflecting thus. And that is that I started reflecting on that really state of marvel, that I could see that within that state of pure consciousness and tremendous love, there is still one step that remains. And that is very difficult to see, because for most people it's like, wow, I have achieved this, what else is there to achieve? But what I noticed with quite a few years with many teachers, gurus, monks, that there can be a sense of I. And what is that sense of I? It is that sense that something has been achieved. There is a very subtle thing that somehow you have a kind of eye vision. You know, you look at things like, I'm enlightened. And a certain sense of being special. You know, I've heard quite a few people that had reached those kind of states, having a feeling and somehow asserting that, oh, now this is the real thing. Yeah, people have had various experiences, but this is the real thing. And we'll discuss it in a second. But I'm not saying, oh, that real thing, that's me, you know. It is very, very much available. But it's usually people that sometimes, not always, but sometimes they don't talk even very much about it, because the realization comes that within that state of being, that I'm pure consciousness and pure love, there is still an I saying, wow, I'm amazing. I'm unique. Now, and the worst one is, now that it has happened to me, it's going to happen to everybody else, because it has come through me. So that is definitely not something that I would ever say, because I don't feel it. So what one begins to see is that I can still make a lot of mistakes. That is the problem. People, many people, when they reach to that state of kind of liberation, they think that's it. I cannot err. I cannot make a mistake because I am enlightened. And the ego that arises from that is quite... it can really catch you and again make you prisoner of its assertion, of its pride, of its unicity. But when you realize that even when all of these states of being have been seen and understood, then it comes the real freedom, because you discover that at any time you can be pretty stupid. And the most important thing that you can say, that you can share from your heart, is, I was wrong. Oh God, I have to say sorry to that person. I have to move back and realize and grow by realizing that I can be really wrong. And as long as we live, as long as we are in one planet or another, I don't know in other states what happens, but as long as we are vibrating, alive, conscious, we are always capable of making huge mistakes. And then the state of love that comes from that is even stronger in its simplicity. It's really, really baby-like. And you're not attached to anything. You're definitely not attached to the I am enlightened. And I have often been asked that, oh, are you enlightened? And I said, there is no particular I in here that says I am enlightened. Because the moment I say that, I grow another personality occasionally. It can happen, not always, but I say, be careful. So what I'm saying, keep moving, and don't get attached to any state of being, including enlightenment. And just be simple and just realize, you know, your silliness and the importance to discuss certain things with certain people, and realize that I have to step back a little, learn a lot, and move on like that. So even what I'm saying, the great state of love, the pure consciousness, can become traps, and they can become the worst traps that you can have, because other people, sometimes we are pretty blind and so forth, but we move on, and then we say something else a bit silly and so forth, but we don't create an enlightened persona, which is a little bit difficult. To really live in a state of really simplicity. And don't be afraid about having bad moments, having sadness, having confusion. It's okay. When it comes up, it's okay. We are just humans, and we can make mistakes, and we can be silly, and we have to learn anew. And when you are there and you surrender to that state of ignorance, the fact that we don't know and that we are confused and that we are extremely sad, it's okay. I am sad. I am sad. And I can't guarantee it to you, but I can tell you that most times that love comes back with such a kindness, with such a gentleness, with such a beautiful caress, that it is worth giving up all that unnecessary crown and just live as it is. Sometimes dancing in the clouds, and sometimes, as I said before, feeling sadness, feeling low. It is life in all its beauty, in all its importance. And then it becomes quite genuine, to a great extent. Okay, thanks for having listened to me, and I hope that it'll be good for you.